Hey, yep, check, two, two, yep, good.
Worship experience.
Good evening, New Salem. Good evening. It's time to start our celebration, last night of revival. I want to invite you to stand with me and read June 24 and 25. To him who is able, keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, clap, put your hands together. Praise the Lord, everybody. Clap your hands if you love Jesus. Clap your hands if you love Jesus.
Oh, yes, I'm breathing out.
bless the Lord. Oh, as long as I'm breathing, oh yes, I'm breathing, I'll bless the Lord. Thank you, God. Say, I will bless.
I will bless the Lord at all times.
And his praises
shall continually be in my mind.
No matter what I see.
No matter what I see or how I feel.
As long as I'm breathing.
As long as I'm breathing.
Oh, yes.
Lost, but now I'm found. I am a member of the care of care group called Garden Keepers. And right about now, it is my privilege, my distinct honor, for you to come and go with me into the garden. May we bow our heads, and if you like, you can close your eyes. I come before you tonight, and I want to share with you what I'm going to do. I want to have a little talk with Jesus. And if it's okay with you, I want you to come with me. We're going to go into this garden. And in this garden, the dew is still wet on the roses. And in this garden, there are more than one kind of roses. There's a rose of Sharon. And that rose has been identified in memory after Mary, Jesus' mother. It is magnificent, it has virtue, and it is considered one of the most beautiful flowers in the ancient world. As we go through this garden, Lord, I've noticed that there's a lily of the valley. And that lily of the valley was said to be pure. It was virtuous, and my Lord is pure and virtuous. Now in my life, I have a confession, because confession is good for the soul. And I've been more disobedient than I have been obedient. But I'm here and I stand in front of you to tell you, this man that I call my God is like no other. As we continue to go through this garden and we see all the beauty and majesty that he has put here for our sake, not his sake, but our sake. There's nothing that my God can't do. It doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. He has created this garden, and he has brought into the night the bright and shining star. And I'm told by those who write these scriptures that it's the brightest star in the early morning. I am not alone. He is walking with us. He is walking beside us. And he tells us we are his own. We go through this garden and we walk out into a pasture. And we can lay down beside the still waters. Those waters are cool. They can quench any thirst. But just because they're still doesn't mean they're dead. It's living water. It's living water. And from here, we go up on the hill, and I find that my Lord has built a house, and in that house are many mansions. I am blessed beyond compare. I don't deserve it, but I'm worthy. I'm worthy because he has waited on me to come to him. He's waited on me to come to him. I haven't been what I should be, but I'm not what I was and not what I'm gonna be. I am so glad that he waited on little old me. Father, it is a blessing to be here in the house one more time. I know that you've got a providential preacher who's gonna bring a mighty word. I know that he is your servant. I know that he is favored, and I know that I'm blessed. Blessed with your amazing grace. Blessed with the pureness and the forgiveness of you. Father, I can do no wrong, and I know I'm not finished, and I'm still a piece of work, a huge piece of work. But you still love me, you provide me, even though the road sometimes gets lonely, and even though sometimes I forget to thank you, you still love me. You still give me what I need when I don't have enough sense to ask for it myself. Father, I don't know where this is going to go, and I don't know how long I got, but I know this. I ain't much, but I'm all I got. And because of you, that's more than enough. Father,
a good time tonight. And life hasn't always been kind to me or you. I know some folks are hurting. Some folks got it worse than me. And yes, there's some folks that got it better than me. But through it all, not some of it, not a little bit of it, not most of it, but all of it, through all of it, you are Lord and Savior. You sent a man here in your image. Some call him the King of Kings. Some call him the Prince of Peace. Some call him Jehovah. I call him Emmanuel. Father, if it weren't for you, if it weren't for you, none of us would be in this house. Things are getting lonely. Things get tough sometimes, Father. But I know that suffering in the night means that there'll be joy in the morning. Suffering in the night, those dreamless, sleepless nights you had, and you don't know why, it's all right. When the morning comes, there'll be joy. There will be joy. I heard a preacher say not too long ago that life has its ups and downs, and you can't always have your way. You can't always get what you want, but He is there, and He just asks that you come. Come just as you are. Come just where you are. Father, all these things are what we call life, and He makes it possible. I know that sometimes it's hard to find a silver lining in things. I know that sometimes it's hard to get along with others. And I know sometimes it's hard to keep you at the front of our minds. But I heard this preacher tell me, no matter how hard, no matter how broken you are, he said, do four things, four simple words, four one-syllable words. One word is a verb. One word is a pronoun. One word is an adjective, and the one word is a noun. And he says, and I'll be done, he says, count it all joy. He says, count it all joy. When you don't know how you're going to pay your rent, when you don't know how you're going to get to your job because you have no transportation, when your children acting up and you're a single parent, or where you got a marriage that doesn't seem like it's being held together, look up, stretch out, count it all joy. Count it all joy. Father, you are wonderful. The one that you made in your image, he is magnificent. We call him Wonderful Counselor. He can do what no other one can do. There are no other God but you. Right now, Father, I thank you. I love you. I adore you. And I'm going to leave here as I count it all joy. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
that. Sing that with us.
There's no one like you.
Watches over every sparrow, how much more will he love you? If he does that for all of those things, just think about what he'll do for you. Think about all the ways that he's making for you, right, even right now, that you don't even see. He's great and he's mighty and he's worthy to be praised. He's an awesome God. He's an awesome God.
Just say amen. It's a great day to be alive. It's a great day to be alive. It's a great day to be alive. I want you to Celebrate the person next to you. Celebrate the person next to you. We are grateful for the last evening of revival. You made it. Celebrate yourself. Some of y'all was here all three nights. Some made two, and some, this is the first night. We sort of like the talents. We don't care when it started, long as you get the one and you get it in. Amen? Amen. We're grateful for that. We're going to ask our ushers to make the shift as we get ready to lift this evening's offering. I need you to listen to me. Everything we do in this offering tonight is going to go to our evangelist who's been blessing us all week long. Y'all didn't hear me. I didn't say it was going to go to me. It's going to go to the evangelist who's been blessing us all week long. So I need you to put up the Cash App for those who are going to do it that way. Pretty sure we have that. I'm going to wait till we get there. There we go. All right. Everybody can see that? That's going to give electronically? All right. Now it's going to go straight to him. Amen? That'll be between him, God, and whoever else he got to split it with. Amen. All right. And the grandbaby. This is the grandbaby fund. Lord, thank you for blessing us with the ministry of Dr. Clavon Lee. He has made us a better congregation, a better people, better pastor, better servants. Now, God, we come wishing to express not a token of appreciation, but an expression of love. And love is not what it says, but what it does. So this gives us a chance, God, to individually reflect how he has blessed us. We ask all this in your son's name. Amen, amen, amen. If you're going to write a check, it should also be made to Dr. Clavon Lee. Now, we know how checks are. Make sure it's on the account that's active. And the one that can cover what we're going to write, amen? He'll be all the way in California. I don't want him calling me, amen? All right, let's go. Did that kind of quick, but we okay. Amen. It is not really necessary anymore to introduce him to this congregation. I think since Monday evening, he has more than done an adequate job of letting us know who he is and what he is capable of and all that God has put inside of him to be a blessing to us. I am grateful as your pastor that you have been here and been supportive and encouraging. We often talk as preachers, there's nothing worse than going to do a revival and ain't nobody there in terms of that. So we're grateful for those of you here and our virtual crowd as well. So we're not going to delay this any longer after the choir comes and gives us one other selection. Our evangelist and pastor for the last 3 days will come and close us out the way the Lord leads him to do what needs to be done. We do want to remind you that upon completion of this, you will be able to sign up for missions and ministry in our foyer, as we want to get you involved and maturing in your relationship, not just coming to church, but be having a missions and a ministry as a part of the New Salem Church. Amen. Just tell the person next to you, you know you need to sign up for something. Some of y'all didn't say nothing. You know you need to sign up for something. Amen? Amen. All right, praise and worship leaders.
A big God. Clap your hands if you serve a big God.
Big.
the big guy.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We're alive. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to every generation, even ours. And we give him thanks, glory, honor, and praise. I greet you tonight in the priceless and precious name of our perfect Prince of Peace, whose name is Jesus, the Christ of Nazareth, the one in whom we live, move, and have our very being. And what a joy it is to have had this precious time with you, the wonderful people of God that make up the New Salem Church, along with the friends throughout the Columbus community during this week of simultaneous revival, this time of simultaneous spiritual renewal. And I cannot give thanks to God enough for your inimitable pastor and my dear brother in the person of Pastor Reverend Dr. Keith Troy. Would you join me one more time? Yeah, one more time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can I just say, he's just so cool. I mean, he's just so smooth. He's just a smooth, cool cat. You know what I mean? You know, nothing ruffles his feathers. He just takes everything in stride. Now, he'll get you. Don't let the smooth taste fool you, right? But he's just such a wonderful brother, always has been, and I'm so grateful, man, for the trust that you have given to me. Brothers and sisters, we're living in the days that Paul spoke of to Timothy, where people would not endure sound doctrine, but would flock to themselves those who would tell them what their itching ears wanted to hear. And so anytime a pastor allows someone else to stand in the pulpit that God has given them responsibility for, it's a sacred trust. Because somebody can come in and say something stupid in 30 minutes that'll take you 6 months to try to correct and clean up. And so would you join me again for celebrating your pastor, his spiritual guidance, his being tapped into the Holy Spirit, and his high standards. Amen. And he has high standards, and I know that he brought me here because he remembers what Dr. Benjamin Elijah Mays began to say to the students of Morehouse College when we enrolled as freshmen. And that is that Morehouse places a crown above your head that's so high that you spend the rest of your life trying to grow tall enough to wear it. And so he knew that I hadn't yet arrived, and so he wanted to give me an opportunity to grow some more, man. Thank you, bro. I'm a few inches taller as a result of this week. I thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And to the hardest working woman, the hardest working first lady I've seen anywhere, would you join me in thanking God for and celebrating First Lady Brenda Troy? She's the commander general, the floor general, the ground general. If you need some ground troops, she's the one. So the next time you watch Woman King, just see her. Just see her. I'm just grateful for their family. It's just so wonderful. You know, some families are just blessed families in an unusual way, and that's the Troy family, and I'm grateful for every member of the family and to all of you that make up the leadership, the clergy, the discipleship of this church. I'm grateful. It's been a wonderful week, and I'm glad to have had this opportunity. Let me also commend you, New Salem. I've been doing this for a long time now, and I've discovered that over time, churches take on the personalities of their pastor. So whatever the pastor is usually reflected in the members, right? If the pastor's mean and rude, you know, and snobbish, then usually that shows up somewhere in the members. But when the pastor is loving and kind and generous and understands the need to give back to the community and to be love and not just talk love, it also shows in the church body, and it's shown up in you just this week. And so I celebrate you. Give yourselves a big hand tonight. Amen. Amen. I want to call your attention to the word of God on this last night that we have together. You bought all of the books as Pastor asked you to do, so thank you so much. Thank you so much for that. And we're going to make sure that you have the information that you need to be able to order books beyond tonight and be able to have them in your possession. And I pray that each book will indeed be a blessing in your life or in the lives of those to whom you gift the book to the glory of God. I didn't want to preach this message tonight, but I just can't get away from it. And so I'm learning still after all of these years that the Holy Ghost always knows better than I do. And so I want to call your attention to the Gospel of Luke chapter 5. For some of you, it will be a familiar passage, and for others of you, it will be a new passage. Dr. Charles Edward Booth used to teach us that whenever you come to a familiar well, you need to try to pull up some fresh water. And I believe that there's some fresh water in this old well. The Gospel of Luke chapter 5, and the story begins with verse 17 and ends with verse 26. As you find it, if you're physically able, would you stand for the reading of God's holy word? Thank you again, Music Ministry, for your ministry all week long. Y'all have been wonderful. Thank you so much. The Gospel of Luke chapter 5, beginning with verse 17. The passage concludes at verse number 26, but for the sake of time, I just want to read through verse 20. The New International Version translates the original Greek New Testament in this way: one day, Jesus was teaching, and Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there. They had come from every village of Galilee and from Judea and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was with Jesus to heal the sick. Some men carrying a paralyzed man on a mat came and tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. When they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on his mat through the tiles into the middle of the crowd, right in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." Heaven and earth may pass away, but God's word will stand forever. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Look at verse 20 again with me, if you will. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." By now, you know, I believe that when there is prayer in the pew, there's more power in the pulpit for proclamation. And so I solicit your prayers with me and for me. Tonight, I want to talk to you about faith-filled friends. Faith-filled friends. Faith-filled friends. When he saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." Faith filled friends. I ask you to keep your Bibles open. Do your best not to go to sleep. I don't want you to accuse me of making anything up. By now, I am convinced in just 3 days that all of you have and have had a very broad playlist for your music listening pleasure. I am also confident that many of you all remember a song that went something like this: "Friends, How many of us, see, I already knew, I didn't even get past the fourth word. How many of us have them? Friends, ones we can depend on. Friends, how many of us have them? Before we go any further, let's be friends. Is a word we use every day. Most of the time we use it in the wrong way. Now you can look the word up again and again, but the dictionary doesn't know the meaning of friends. And if you ask me, you know I couldn't be much help, because a friend, somebody you judge for yourself. Some are okay and they treat you real cool, and some mistake your kindness for being a fool. We like to be with some because they're funny. Others come around only when they need some. Some you grew up with around the way, and they're real close to this very day. Homeboys through the summer, winter, spring, and fall. And then there's some we wish we never knew at all. And the list goes on again and again, but these are the people that we call.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Houdini understood that there is something special about real friends. Real friends are not new. Real friends are tried, tested, and true. Real friends identify themselves as such in bad times and not just good times. Real friends are there with you in the times of gloom and grief, and not just the times that are good and glorious. Real friends are there in times of hardship and not just times of happiness. Real friends are there when life is sour and not just when life is sweet. Real friends are people that are there for you when others are running you down in the streets, and they have the capacity to defend you and be there for you and believe the best in you no matter what others are saying about you. Real friends are those that are real, ride or die. That they're going to be your boy, they're going to be your girl, they're going to be with you no matter what. And even the worst in you cannot make them doubt the best in you, because they are a real friend. They don't ever want to get away from you, they don't want to, and they don't try to, because they're real friends.
Yeah.
And I want to suggest to you tonight that we need to check our friendship circle. And we also need to check our friendship pedigree. I've come tonight to challenge you to check the folks in your circle that you call friends, to see whether or not they are really true friends. But then to also quickly pull the mirror up in front of your own face to determine and assess whether or not you are a real friend. Yeah, I contend tonight that there are many other characteristics that I could have delineated for us that relate to what it means to be a real friend, but there is one category of friends that everyone needs, a type of friend that every Christian should be. I call them faith-filled friends. After all, there are times when life hits you in such a way that in that moment, you don't need a friend just to hang with. You don't need a friend just to party with. You don't need a friend just to travel with. You don't just need a friend to drink with. You don't just need a friend to play cards with. You don't just need somebody to go to the show with, to go to the concert with. In critical moments of your life, you need a faith-filled friend. You need somebody that knows how to pray and get in touch with God on your behalf. You need a friend that will say, hold on, we better stop and pray. Hold on, we need to talk to the Lord. Hold on, I'm going to go to the Lord on your behalf. Some of us have been so caught up in everybody being there and singing our praises and always there to be there in those good times that in the rough times we don't pay attention to the way they show up. And when you are a Christian, and even if you're not, you need somebody that will show up in your life when others walk away, that will say to you, I'm not going to let you go down like this. If you don't have enough faith, don't worry about it. I have enough faith for the both of us, and we're going to go to the Lord together until this thing gets right. Yeah. All of us need some faith-filled friends, and all of us need to be faith-filled friends. Yeah, that's exactly what happens in the story before us tonight. There's a fellow who's paralyzed, which, as you know, means that he cannot walk. And because of his condition, his friends make a decision that they are going to put their faith into action on behalf of their friend. Now, you know that faith always starts with belief. Yeah. You need to check who and what your friends believe in. Let me say to you millennials and you Gen Zs especially, be careful about your friends talking about how spiritual they are. And you don't check where the ground and the basis of their spirituality lies. They might be engaging in what one scholar by the name of Maxie Dunham calls composite religion, where they're borrowing a little bit from Buddhism and Hinduism, and they're a little bit from Islam, and then they're borrowing a little bit from Confucianism, and they're borrowing a little bit from selfism, and they're mixing all of this in with Jesus. When Jesus can stand on his own, because nobody else hung, bled, died, rose, and was ascended and will come back again like Jesus. Faith begins with belief. But then faith acts based on beliefs. You came in tonight and you sat in a pew. We sat in a chair. Because we believed that the seat we sat in was strong enough to hold us. If we had any question about it, we wouldn't have sat down. And if we did sit down, we wouldn't sit down comfortably because we would not have had a strong belief. See, don't be impressed with people who can blab and grab, decree and declare their faith, that can call it and haul it. You need to pay attention not to what they say, but to what they do. Because there are a whole lot of people that learn how to lip faith, but they haven't learned how to live faith. Yeah. Faith proves itself not by what is said alone, but by what one does with their actions. Are you listening? You got to remember that faith always starts with belief. It stands on belief, and as you stand on that belief and put that belief into action, things start to change. Jesus is in a house. He's teaching, and the house is full. These fellows, these friends, we know not how many there were, but these friends looked at their friend who was down, paralyzed, couldn't walk, and said, we know what he needs most. He needs Jesus.
All right, all right.
How many times have you offered your friend everything else but Jesus?
Come on, bro.
How many times have you resorted to your opinion? Well, girl, you know what I think is. Bruh, if it was me, I wouldn't be doing all of that, bruh. I think we ought to. When's the last time you said, let's turn to Jesus? Because that's what faith-filled friends do. They say, we got to get him to Jesus. They get him to Jesus. Because the Bible says, if your Bible is open and you're not going to sleep, I promise I'm not making anything up. The Bible says that these brothers took their friend, carried him on a mat to the very place, the very house where Jesus was teaching. Yeah, yeah. Here it is. I'll show it to you specifically. It says in verse 18, some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a mat and tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. Verse 18. You see that in your Bible? Yeah. What did they do with their faith? What proves that they're faith-filled friends? What will help you to leave this worship tonight and be a better faith-filled friend? What characterizes the faith of faith-filled friends is the real question. First thing that characterizes the faith of faith-filled friends is your faith is affirming. Let the church say affirming. Yeah, yeah, affirming. Your faith is affirming. Not what you talk, but what you do. Can you imagine how this brother who was paralyzed had to feel when his friends decided to literally pick him up and carry him until he got to Jesus? Wow. They were expressing in their action how they felt about their friend and what they believed about their Jesus at the same time. One of the most affirming things you can do for your friend to let them know how much they mean to you, how much you value them, how precious they are to you, is to do whatever you can to get them to Jesus. This brother had to be affirmed because they obviously valued him, listen, too much to leave him in the state that he was in. Can I come to your row tonight? Who in your life do you call a friend that is going through something and you've not said to them, listen, I'm going to make sure I get you to Jesus? Who hollered at you this week? Who DM'd you? Who texted you? Who called you and said, man, I'm going through this, girl, I'm going through this? And you said, child, well, just do the best you can. Hang in there. As opposed to, come on, let's pray before we get off the phone. Come on, I'm going to roll up to your house right now. I'm coming to your apartment right now. I'm coming to your job. Let's meet for lunch. Let's meet after work. We're going to pray together. Because I'm not going to let you slip on a banana peel with one foot and the other foot on a nervous breakdown. I'm not going to let it happen. It's not going to happen on my watch. You're not going to go down on my watch. You may have fallen down, but I'm not going to let you stay down on my watch because you matter too much to me. You're too valuable to me. I care too much about you as my friend to not do everything in my power to get you to the one that I know can turn your situation around.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I hope this is making sense. Now note something else. They weren't carrying him around out of pity. They were carrying him around because they were practicing their faith. Your friend doesn't need pity when they're depressed. Your friend doesn't need pity when they've lost their job. They don't need pity when they're going through a marital crisis. They don't need pity when they're going through a divorce. They don't need pity when they're pulling their hair out because of their children. They don't need pity when a loved one is drug addicted or is out on the streets. They don't need pity. They need prayer. They need somebody to get them to Jesus. So when you're a faith-filled friend, your faith is affirming. It lets somebody else know how much you value them and how much you believe that Jesus can handle anything. Yeah. Here's the second thing, if you keep following the story. Not only does faith from faith-filled friends show itself to be affirming, but secondly, your faith is aggressive. All right. Let the church say aggressive. Aggressive. Yeah, your faith is aggressive. Now note, when they got to the house, verse 19, when they got to the house, they were met with a problem. Jesus was there. They got the man to where Jesus was located, but they had difficulty getting their friend into Jesus' actual presence. Right. And these brothers allowed their faith to become aggressive to the point at which they exercised a dogged determination that no matter what, they were going to get their boy in front of Jesus. The front door was blocked because the house was full. Couldn't get through the windows because folks were standing around the walls. In all likelihood, there was no back door. It was only one way in and one way out. And so what were they to do? And look at what these brothers did. They climbed up onto the roof. Let's stop right there. I need you to get the videographic image in your mind. A one-story house, but nevertheless, they've got to pick a man up who, because of his paralysis, is dead weight. And they've got to lift him up to get him on the roof. How much lifting are you willing to do for a friend? Can you lift a friend who's heavy without making them feel like they're a burden? They lift this brother up. I don't know how in the world they did it. I don't know how many of them there were. Maybe there were four. Let's just say there were four of them carrying him on a cot. Each one took one end of the cot. So two of them had to climb up on the roof first. Then they had to try to stabilize one another so that one of them at least could reach down while the other two on the ground lifted their friend up on the cot, and they were pushing from the bottom while the others were pulling from the top, and they were trying to be careful with him because the last thing they wanted to do was to drop him. Can I ask you some questions tonight as I keep going along my way? How do you handle your friends? Because if they're really a friend, it matters to you whether or not you drop them. If they don't matter to you, if they're not a real friend, you don't give a hoot about what happens to them. You say, let him get up on his own. He puts his pants on just like I do. She's been grown a long time. She ought to be able to handle herself by now. But when you're a real friend, They can be heavy, but never be a burden. Yeah. And so here they are. Somehow they get him up onto the roof. That's aggressive, y'all. That's aggressive. They stand up for their friend because he couldn't stand up for himself. You remember the Tennessee Three? The Tennessee Three were made up of Justin Pearson, Justin Jones, and Gloria Johnson, who were expelled from the House floor of Tennessee the other year for protesting and advocating for gun law reform in the aftermath of a recent school shooting that resulted in the loss of multiple lives. They said, no, we're not gonna allow this to keep going on. We're gonna be aggressive to the point at which it may get us expelled, but we believe too much in the protection and sanctity of life out of the womb, as much or more as those anti-abortionists believe in life and its sanctity in the womb. Let me just throw in for free, Pastor Troy, excuse me right here. Let me jump on and off of my soapbox. Y'all need to be careful about this right-wing Christian conservative evangelical posture that is so upset about women having abortion. And they care so much about life in the womb. But excuse my expression, they don't give a damn about life out of the womb. They can go from school to prison. They can go from school to the streets. They don't give a hoot about their lives. They can be gunned down by police. They can be gunned down by their peers. And they don't care. If you are really pro-life, you got to be one who is anti-abortion on one hand, but you protect the sanctity of life out of the womb. And not just in the womb. If you're going to put Jesus' name on something, you better put him on the things that really matter and not just in a little corner. These brothers in this story become aggressive, unrelenting, indomitable. They are wise. They are indefatigable. They are determined that they're going to get their friend to Jesus no matter what it takes. And when they get up on the roof, they tear the roof off the sucker. Excuse me, Clavin Lee Jr. is coming out. They tore the roof off the sucker. And the Bible says they let him down right in front of Jesus. Their faith was so aggressive that they interrupted the service. When's the last time? I ain't trying to start nothing, so please don't blame it on me and say you were led by the Spirit. But when's the last time you had a friend with you in church that was really going through and it was so bad that you knew that you needed to bring them to the altar and it wasn't altar call time? These brothers were so serious about their faith on behalf of their friend that they were aggressive to the point at which it disrupted the status quo. How much are you willing to go to bat for your friends? How aggressive are you willing to be for your friends? If you find out that your friend's child is having difficulty at their school and you know how the system works, do you have enough faith to show up with them at the school, walk into the administrative offices, demand a meeting with the principal, and read them the riot act in the name of Jesus? Without compromising your character because you know how the system works, do you love and care enough about your friend to be aggressive enough to go talk to the DA or to go talk to the judge or to make a call or to send a message? Because you know they do favors for other folks' children. And since you got a hookup, why not use it for your friend's child? That's aggressive faith. Is anybody listening tonight? So if you're a faith-filled friend, your faith is characterized by affirming faith. Your Faith is affirming. Your faith is aggressive. But then your faith, thirdly, is authenticated. Somebody say authenticated. Yeah, in other words, it's proven to be real. How do you know? Is your Bible open? Please don't go to sleep. I don't want you to accuse me of making anything up. Once they got their friend to Jesus, and they were able to get through the roof and lower him on his mat into the middle of the crowd, Jesus stops his teaching. And he says, whoa, now that is real faith. This is how Luke puts it. Luke says in verse 20, when Jesus saw not the man's faith who was paralyzed, when Jesus saw their faith, he stopped what he was doing. The fact that it got Jesus' attention is what authenticated it. Do you know that real faith never manipulates Jesus, but always gets the attention of Jesus? You can't manipulate Jesus, but you can get his attention. And when Jesus sees that your faith is authentic, it's sincere, it's not fluff, it's not religious, it's pure, it's going to get Jesus' attention. And if it ever gets his attention, it is going to move Jesus to action. Help somebody tonight, Jesus. Yeah, he stops because he sees their faith. Again, faith is not what you lip, it's what you life. All right. It doesn't say when Jesus heard of their faith. There's some other stories in the New Testament about Jesus hearing about somebody's faith, but in this story, Jesus doesn't hear, Jesus sees. What have you been showing Jesus that you really believe about him? How many of you have given up on friends and on family? Not just because you don't believe in them. The problem is you really don't believe in Jesus. Well, you know he always been that way, and his daddy was that way, and his uncle was that way, and his granddaddy was that way. Does that mean he has to stay that way? Well, you know, she ain't nothing, and her mama wasn't nothing, and her aunties weren't nothing, and her grandmama wasn't nothing. Does that mean she's got to stay that way? You know, that whole family been like that for generations. Do they have to stay that way? Are you projecting your lack of faith in Jesus into your lack of faith in them? Do you not believe that he is still a chain breaker? Do you not still believe that he is a yoke destroyer? Do you not still believe that he is a generational curse reverser? You know what really messes with me is that there are folks in the street that sometimes are better friends than folks in the church. I got a couple of guys in my life that say, Pastor, look, we want you to know we street loyal. And if you ever lived in the streets, you know what that means. That means there's no play, ain't no faking. They'll do whatever they got to do for you because they loyal to you. They care about you that much. They always will be looking out for you. And sometimes we stop believing in people. And the real truth is that we've really lessened and lowered our belief and faith in Jesus. All right, sir. Can you imagine? They walk all this way. We don't know how many miles, but they walk all of these way, carrying this man. They finally get to Jesus. The house is full. They can't get in. They have to climb up on the roof. They have to lift their friend up on the roof. Then they have to lower him down on the roof. Nobody's concerned about whether or not they're going to pull their back, whether or not they're going to strain a muscle. They get him in front of Jesus, and they still don't have a guarantee that Jesus is going to do anything. Yet, when they do what they do, Jesus is moved to do what he does. I'm gonna bring it on in because I'm feeling good tonight. They get him in front of Jesus. Jesus stops and he sees their faith, and that was an authentication of their faith. Let me help somebody out, and I promise I'll move toward a close. Some of you are saying, well, preacher, I don't have a whole lot of faith. Guess what? You're in good company. Because there was a fella in the Bible who had a son who had seizures as a result of demons. And the father brought his boy to Jesus' disciples, but they couldn't do anything with the boy. Jesus showed up. He said, hey, what's going on? He said, well, I brought my boy to your disciples, and they couldn't do anything with him. Jesus said, what's the problem? Well, he falls on the ground, and he foams at the mouth, and he has these seizures, and I just thought if you could do anything. He said, oh, if I can do anything? He said, the question is not if I can do anything. The question is, do you believe? And here's what the father said in full transparency. Well, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. In other words, I believe, but I've been disappointed so many times. I believe, but I've been let down so many times. I believe, but I've been hurt so many times. I believe, but I've become despondent so many times. I believe, but I'm so depressed right now that I don't know if you really can and will do it, but I believe you might be able to. Can I just tell you, friend, whatever level of faith you have, as long as it's authentic, Jesus will honor it. Jesus will honor it when you exercise it. Here it is, final thing. Jesus looks at the man. He says, friend, your sins are forgiven. Did you catch it? Maybe you're like the Pharisees and the teachers of the law in the next verse, because they were saying to themselves, who's this fella? Talking about your sins are forgiven. He's speaking blasphemy. Nobody can forgive sins but God. Jesus says, hey, why are you thinking that way? Why are you thinking that way in your own head? I can hear and I can read your thoughts. It would have been easier for me to just tell the man, get up and walk, but he had a deeper issue. And I argue on my way to a close that his friends didn't even know how deep his issues were. And I know some of y'all think that you're tighter than thieves. I know some of y'all think that you know your friends better than anybody else knows them. But it might be that there's something else going on that is contributing to their condition that only Jesus can fix. Yeah. You trying to help them with relationship challenges, when it's deeper than that, they've got childhood trauma. You ain't gonna be able to fix that. A therapist may not be able to get to all of that, but Jesus can. Is anybody listening tonight? So when they exercise their faith, Jesus says to the man, friend, your sins are forgiven you. And then he says, take up your mat and walk. The man walks out carrying what was carrying him. All because of the faith of his friends. Do you see that? And here's the final thing that you got to see, is that when your faith is real, when you're a real friend,
Your faith is affirming. Your faith is aggressive. Your faith is authenticated. And finally, your faith has an after effect. Somebody say after effect. Yeah. Your faith has an after effect. Here it is at the end of the passage. The Bible says that when Jesus spoke to this man and told him to get up and take his mat that he had been lying on, the Bible says immediately he stood up in front of him, took what he had been lying on, and went home praising God. And everybody was amazed and gave praise to God, and they were filled with awe, saying that we have seen remarkable things today. In other words, after they exercised their faith, there was an after effect. The man ended up walking home excited and relieved and praising God and jumping up and down and excited because of what the Lord had done. Not in response to his faith, but because of his faith-filled friends. And then not only did he go home praising God, but then everybody around him started praising God also, because they said, oh my God, the faith of friends is a powerful thing. It made Jesus stop his teaching and start healing this man right in front of our eyes. What would it be like for you to go home tonight? Call all your boys and call all your girls. Say, hey, let's meet up tonight. Why are we going to meet up? What y'all trying to do tonight? Y'all trying to drink? Y'all trying to hang? Y'all trying to party? No, we're going to have a praise session. And we're going to give thanks to God because Pookie and Ray Ray and Raniqua and Shaquita were delivered from what they were dealing with. They ain't struggling no more. Jesus has healed them. Jesus has delivered them. Jesus has brought them out. Jesus has saved them. Jesus has lifted them up. Jesus has pulled them in. Jesus has restored them. Jesus has transformed them. Jesus has made a difference in their lives. I'm out of here now. My soul is happy, but I'm going to my seat because you know now that God wants you to be a faith-filled friend. And when you are a faith-filled friend, then God will honor your faith on your friend's behalf, because you knew who the ultimate friend was. When I was a boy, we used to sing a hymn in the church. What a friend we have in Jesus. All of our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pains we bear. Oh, because, oh Jesus, I'm going to my seat. We do not carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, if you pray, he'll work it out. If you get on your knees for your friend, you'll see him turn everything around. Won't he do it? Oh, yes, he will.
If you do what she's been through, you shout too. Thank you. faith-filled friends. Is anybody saved or healed or helped because they're your friend? We tend to focus on coming to Christ for us. Bless me, bless my house. Fix this, fix that. But when's the last time you exercised your intercessor responsibilities? We can be so selfish with Jesus. And God is so big, he can do me and you at the same time and not take away from either one of us. Sometimes we're so busy doing church, we miss the Holy Spirit. And last night, I didn't act on something the Holy Spirit was urging me to do. And it was confirmed by two other sources. And I told the Lord, if you give me another chance, I'm going to go back and make right what I should have did last night. So tonight, what we want to do is we come to closure on our revival. Whether you've still got arrows in your quiver, or you haven't really been a faith-filled friend, we're going to open up the altar and give you the opportunity to get it right with him. Not me, not anybody else. But some of us been blessed more than we have shared with God has given us. Clavon hit that thing hard last night. And I let some of y'all go home with arrows that you should have left and shot last night. And you fooled around and showed up again. Well, I'm not going to be guilty of that tonight. God has blessed you over and over and over and over again. And you stopped at 3 when he gave you 5. You stopped at 2 when he gave you 6. You thought God was going, I dare you to come to this altar and say to God, God, tonight I am emptying out my quiver. Because I'm trusting you. I'm going back with more than I came for. So if you're here tonight, and you know you need to empty out that quiver. You know you need to be a better friend. You know God was haunting you last night like he was haunting me. Come on to the altar. It's for you. It's for you. Trust God tonight. God, here's my quiver. God, here's my quiver. God, I'm going to shoot all the arrows I got left. I'm not going to worry about next week or tomorrow. Somebody needs to know tonight. Somebody needs to know as soon as I leave this place that I got enough faith as a friend to intercede on their behalf. Clay, I'm always amazed about that story because nowhere in the story does it say the man asked to be healed. They took the initiative and did for their friend what he couldn't do for himself. How many more folks you gonna see in pain and not go to God on their behalf? How many more folks you gonna see about to lose their household and not go to God for them on their behalf? God lets you see stuff. So you can ask for stuff that folk can't ask for themselves. Are you sure I'm not waiting on you? If it's too long a walk, just stand where you are. If it's too long a walk, just stand where you are. But I dare you tonight to trust God with the rest of your arrows. Somebody's waiting to be blessed with your arrow. Grab somebody's hand. God, thank you for second chances and third and fourth and 10 and 20. However many chances we need to get it right. God, we've been blessed as a congregation over and over and over again. You remind him as we came in tonight that there's still needs. As we walked in, I saw ladies from the neighborhood who could not speak English. The week has reminded us again and again that it pays to serve you, and it pays every single day. And you have richly blessed this congregation. And I hear you asking, what are you going to do with the blessings I've given you? So, God, we repent. Because we chose comfort over commitment. God, we apologize. Because we'd rather be at ease in Zion than make sacrifices for our children and grandchildren. God, remind us how we got here. It's 4.5 miles from 47 North Champion Avenue. But God, those folk had a faith and a belief that bordered on the impossible. And God, if they had that kind of faith, what kind of faith should we have since we've been the benefactor of their actions and their faith? How much more should we? Why do we have to beg folk to do what you've called them to do? In order for us to be mature Christians, we ought to have a ministry and a mission. Where in the Bible does you call us to attend? You call us to work, to make a difference, to sacrifice, to pray, to fast. It's always action involved in following you. So tonight, God, we're going to shoot all the arrows. We need to shoot an arrow for folk we work with. We need to shoot an arrow for family members who are struggling with their faith. A wayward child, a confused spouse, a distant cousin, an unforgiving parent. God, remind us of the power you have given us to intercede on behalf of folks who don't even know they need to be healed. God, activate our faith. God, remind us we are wonderfully and marvelously made. Remind us again to speak life to our children over and over again. Then, God, thank you for this preacher who has traveled across the country to remind us some things can be delayed but not denied. Thank you for the power in which he preached. We ask that you look over his physical and his spiritual family while he's gone. We pray traveling mercies on tomorrow for he and Brother Eric as they seek to go back. And we pray that he finds all things well, God, But God, we want to empty out our quiver. And if we'll shoot one or two arrows, who knows whose child might be saved? Who knows whose wayward son may come home? God, remind us again, there's healing in the house. There's forgiveness in the house. There's restoration in the house. There's release in the house. There's freedom in the house. There's liberation in the house. It's your servant's prayer. Let's collectively say it. Amen, amen, and amen. Give somebody a dap hug on your way back to your seats. I need you. Thank you, preacher. Thank you, preacher. Oh, come on. Thank you, preacher. Amen. Very quickly, a couple things I need to update you on, and we'll be ready to leave here. I want you to put these dates down. April 6th through April the 9th. April 6th through April the 9th. 2025. We already checked with your assistant to make sure that we had clearance on those dates. Yeah. So, one of the things I forgot to tell you, it's a 2-year contract. And since we weren't able to get you here on Sunday, we felt kind of cheated, so we just want you to be able to make it right. So we made sure it wasn't on your anniversary next year, so we ahead of the ball game. All right, we'll talk more, but we certainly want to have him back next year as our featured evangelist at the New Salem Church. Amen. The emotion carried. Praise the Lord. I'm glad we didn't have to make one. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. I do want to remind you that Doc had his books. We sold out of the books. Thank you for your obedience, and thank you for your investing in him. It's up on the screen. You can see how you can go in and get a book directly. You can purchase books of copies, Giants Lessons, and all of that. Send an email to fabie@cljministries.org, and they will be able to take care of you directly. Amen? Amen? All right. If you can't write that fast, just screenshot it, and then you'll have it. See, I'm learning. I got my grandchildren teaching me how to do stuff a whole lot quicker. Amen? All right. We're trying to update our membership database, so we need your help. Please scan or the QR card on the screens. They're going to put that up. Or use the Shelby Next app. Now, a unique thing about the app we have, you can go in and update your information. Now, it will not bother our database because all that is you're sending it to us. We will look at it, and then we will actually put it in. But we need you to give us the information. Amen? Tell the person that you know you done moved four times, and you ain't told the church not once. And you know you got a promotion, and you ain't told them about your new job. We got to go to LinkedIn to find out about your promotion. All right, so let's get this so that we can have current, updated information. Amen? Amen. I think that's tonight we had a focus on our missions and ministry. We know that everybody leaves here is going to sign up to be involved in missions and ministry. Amen? Okay, so seven more of y'all going to sign up for missions and ministry. I don't know why y'all make preachers work so hard. The man just preached all night long. And okay, we're going to be all right. We're going to be all right. According to our faith. Amen? All right, directors, anything else I'm leaving out? How many folk do we end up feeding tonight? 175 people? Praise the Lord for feeding 175 people. Carper, you got something you want to tell your grandfather? You raise your hands. Anything you need to tell me? Bob is glad to see you. I want you to know that. All right? Bob has missed you. I don't know why you've been kept from seeing Bob, but Bob was glad to see you tonight. All right. Thank you, Carver, for coming. Amen. And bringing your parents with you. You're doing such a good job. Amen. Love you. They're going to be mad. They'll be all right. All right. Praise and worship team, thank you guys for all week long. Love you. You did such a good job. I'm going to give you all the sixth Sunday of this month off. Amen. Y'all don't have to show up on the sixth Sunday, amen? We good? All right, praise the Lord, amen. Y'all good? Musicians, outstanding as well. Thank you for all that you do. Our ushers, world's greatest ushers, thank y'all for outstanding job. Media, on audio team, y'all especially a huge job for our security folks. Parking went extremely smooth, and we're grateful for that. In terms of that, now I need you to do one other thing. Custodians will be coming in. I need you to take everything you brought with you. Some of y'all be leaving stuff for the lost and found. We don't have one. Take everything that belongs to you with you. Amen? All right. I'm going to have our pastor come back and have final words, and he will close us out. Amen?
Just say thank you again as you stand to Pastor Troy and to all of you. Now, when he was announcing those dates, I was like, oh, they're gonna have a trip or something. They planning a year out. No, for real. I was sitting there like, oh wow. You know, he said 2025. I'm like, oh man, they must be getting ready to do a trip or something like that. You got me, bro. You got me. Lord willing, the creek don't rise. I'll be back though, and I'm honored. I'm honored. Listen. Be the friend that you want somebody else to be. 6 years ago, I was diagnosed with colorectal cancer, stage 3. No issues with my health, no pre-existing conditions, nothing. Exercising, living life, no worries. Out of nowhere, it shows up. And it was the faith of friends that prayed me through. Some of them flew out to California to be there on the day of my surgery. Some of them showed up at the hospital and played music while I was in excruciating pain and prayed me all the way through 39 pounds of weight loss. Just imagine me the weight I am now, 39 pounds lighter. Trying to come back 2 years, major chemo, radiation, surgery, all kinds of stuff, more than I can tell you. But I thank God for friends that had faith in moments where mine dipped and
So be a faith-filled friend, but also start checking your friendship circle so that you know when stuff goes down and life starts lifing, you need to know which one of your friends you can depend on to help get you to Jesus. It's cool to know who you can hang with, party with, all of that's cool and good, right? But you need to know who will pray with you and be there for you and that will support you. And then when the Lord brings you or your friend out of something, go celebrate. Go to a restaurant, say, we hooking up at the restaurant. They say, are you celebrating anything tonight, today? Say, yeah, our friend has been delivered from something. Things turned around. They got a breakthrough, whatever it is, because that's going to be your chance to testify so that other people will know how important it is to have faith-filled friends. So be that friend. Shoot your shots. You got arrows in your quiver. And remember that God is intentional. Everything that's going on in your life, God is going to use it for God's glory and for your advancement. Would you lift your hands? Thank you, Pastor. The Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace from this time forth and even forevermore until we all reach that land beyond sun, moon, and stars, where the friend above all friends, Jesus Christ, will welcome us and we'll enjoy eternity with him. Have a good night, be safe, and be a good friend.